Warning: some of the content in this study covers some controversial issues, and viewer discretion is strongly advised.
You know, even the Jesus story, his biography, is completely unoriginal. You know, all the gods that came before him had like the same birthday.
Now, black people are ticklish on this because black people think that everything in the Bible is true. I question the intelligence of anyone who thinks everything in the Bible is true or supposed to be true.
In the 19th century, many had a fascination with studying the cultures, civilizations, and the kingdoms of the ancient world. And like the ancient Greeks, many in the West had a fascination, almost an obsession, with the ancient Egyptians. And with the discovery and the deciphering of the Rosetta Stone, we now had access into the cultures and civilizations of the ancient world. But many people started to make many challenges. Many started to say that Moses borrowed all of his teachings from the Egyptian Book of the Dead. Were the accusations right? In this study, we're going to challenge what these men have said. We're going to look at the history of ancient Egypt, then we're going to look at the challenges. And as I encourage at all times, everything you see in the study, please research and investigate it for yourself. The country we today call Egypt was originally called by its earliest indigenous population, the land of Kemet. It is geographically located in the northeast corner of Africa, with the second longest river in the world after the Amazon River, the River Nile. And Egypt has been the land bridge between Asia and Africa, but it is also connected to Europe via the Mediterranean Sea. No other nation on earth has left the deepest imprint on mankind, and though it has had one of the oldest and ongoing histories than any other country, we will never be able to have a true consistent knowledge of its in-depth history because archaeologists continue to excavate new artifacts that still baffles modern Western scholars. If you follow the dominant worldview that modern man has reached the pinnacle of human achievements and technological prowess, when you carefully study ancient Egypt, that idea will just crumble. We tend to believe that zoos, where animals are kept in a small enclosure, is new. But guess what? Studies have shown that the ancient Egyptians had zoos also. We can travel across the oceans with the sophistication of modern boats and ships. But guess what? The ancient Egyptians already beat us to it. Most of us have the luxury of sleeping in a comfy, warm bed at night. But guess what? The ancient Egyptians, well, apparently only the elite, also had comfortable beds to sleep in. We think of breweries also as modern inventions, but the oldest brewery on earth, thus far on record, was discovered in Egypt. We praise the artistic genius of modern architecture, but the architecture of ancient Egypt has never even been matched to this very day. We think of diplomacy as an exchange of nations, a product of modern times. But in the British Museum are a number of tablets written in Near Eastern cuneiform that document the diplomacy between the ancient Egyptians and the surrounding nations in the Middle East, in the Orient, as documented in National Geographic. We think of modern computers and its inbuilt digital world of complex wiring, microchips, and soldering as a phenomenon of modern times, and that's exactly what it is. But guess what? Recent studies have shown that ancient Egyptian math is identical to math that is used in modern day computers. The item of women's clothing that we call a dress, how long have they been around for? Prosthetics is a mechanical device that is attached to the body to replace a lost limb. How long has that been around for? Peace treaties that settle disputes between nations, how long have they been around for? And how long have men been drawing geological maps? What is very interesting is that the ancient Egyptians have the oldest dress, the oldest prosthetics, the oldest peace treaty, and the oldest geological map in the world. In the Petrie Museum of Egyptian Archaeology in central London in England, there is an artifact made from granite just lying in a cabinet opposite the front desk. When scholars have closely observed it, they said that this ancient artifact could only have been carved by high-tech powered drills. How is that possible? And how long have men been polishing different forms of stone dug up from the earth? In the Egyptian section of the British Museum, you can clearly see that the ancient Egyptians had an absolute vast knowledge of the different types of rocks in the earth. Their knowledge on geology was amazing and vast, and the narrator can see why people are still intrigued by the Egyptians to this very day. Modern medicine has been generally traced to the Greek culture of the Mediterranean in southern Europe. On London's Gower Street, there is a bust of a man called Hippocrates, the Greek physician, who has been generally titled as the father of medicine. But Herodotus tells us that the Greeks were taught many things by surrounding nations. It was the Egyptians, he said, who originated and taught the Greeks to use ceremonial meetings, processions, and processional offerings. The names of nearly all the gods came to Greece from, guess where? Egypt. In an article published in 2007 titled "How Imhotep Gave Us Medicine" in London's Telegraph newspaper, a portion of the article reads that Professor Rosalie David, director of the KNH Center, said the ancient Egyptians were practicing a credible form of pharmacy long before the Greeks. The ancient Egyptians can be thanked for the introduction of a structural medical and pharmacological system that continues to the present day. And of all the ancient Egyptians, it is Imhotep on the left who was regarded as being the father of medicine. He should have the credit, said Professor David. Now, when we look at the instruments used in modern medical surgery, we are given the impression that these are new tools, but nothing is actually new. In a study titled "Historical Vignettes in Vascular Surgery," the medical instruments on the right from ancient Egypt are the exact same medical instruments that are used today in modern surgery. And in another study titled "Traditional Ancient Egyptian Medicine," a review from the Saudi Journal of Biological Sciences published in March 2021, it documents that the surgery in ancient Egyptian was so advanced, surgeons use various instruments similar to what we're using today, such as the scalpel, forceps, and scissors. Splints were made of reeds tied together by strips of linen or pieces of wood padded with plant of fibers. Even the famous Edwin Smith papyrus, considered as the oldest medical document on earth, has the oldest documented record of an operational procedure being performed on a human body. And that's not the only thing it is known for. As shown in a previous study, modern creams are designed to help moisturize our skin and help to keep it healthy and younger. They discovered that they were doing it in Egypt thousands of years ago. So hey, guess what? Nothing is new unless you believe in the doctrine of natural selection. So who exactly are the ancient Egyptians? For this generates a lot of heated debate. Some seeking for identity and others want to maintain an unchallenged colonial worldview. Now, when you look at some of the very early art, the features that have come down to us show a striking resemblance to the inhabitants of that vast continent in Africa. But over time, their features and complexion begins to change. In most of Egyptian art, their skin tone has a browny red pigment, but some can vary. Some rulers are depicted as jet black. Others are depicted as very, very light skinned. Some mummies show men with light brown blonde hair. And in Egyptian art, women are depicted with woolly or curly black hair. But the narrator is not sure if they are wigs or not. It is difficult to say. But there is one way of seeing who have preserved their culture. When the narrator was growing up as a child, he would spend hours, and I mean hours, watching martial art films. He also temporarily practiced Tai Chi with his next door neighbor. But there was a mysticism about it that the narrator was very, very wary of, so he did not pursue it any further. But when men of that Eastern art trace where the oldest form of martial arts could be traced to, they found themselves, guess where? In Egypt. In a book titled Advanced Karate, published in 1970, the oldest known records concerning combat techniques, hieroglyphic scrolls from where? Egyptian tombs dating as far back as 4000 BC describe military training fights similar to modern boxing, and even prescribing the use of a kind of leather glove that covered the hand and the arm to the elbow, which was later to cross the Mediterranean to Greece. While many think these mesmerizing moves with a stick can be traced to the school of Shaolin in Asia, it is far older and can be traced to the hieroglyphics in ancient Egyptian tombs in North Africa, where they practiced this martial art. But it has still been preserved among the black Nubians in Egypt who still practice this art form. And when blacks of British and French plantations entertained themselves in Dominica in the Caribbean during slavery, they still practiced this art form with the sticks. This is all they had because they weren't allowed to read nor go to church. And when you look at these distinct hand movements from the Egyptian tombs that you can still see in modern Eastern martial arts, it was still practiced among the slaves in Brazil in South America, where they carried that ancient art form across the Atlantic. And you can still see the oldest known form of martial art is still preserved and practiced among blacks in Brazil, whether they be male or female. This is known as capoeira. But how vast was Egyptian influence on surrounding nations and on our modern world? One of the ancient Egyptians' most common religious emblems was of a winged globe. It looked like a blazing sun in the center being held up by bird's wings. And when you look at Neo-Assyrian art and art throughout Western Asia, you see the Egyptian influence on the cultures of the Orient. Even when foreign kings invaded Egypt, they also adopted the attire of the Egyptians. This is a cylinder seal of King Darius in the British Museum in the Medo-Persian section, but he is also depicted in that section as an Egyptian god. So you see even the influence on foreign invaders. This is a medal of Ptolemy I in the British Museum, which the narrator believes he had minted. But as he ruled Egypt, in the same museum, you can also see him as a pharaoh with the distinct headdress. And all over the West, their capital cities are just filled with obelisks from Egypt. It is like the modern world also wants to hold on to the legacy of one of the oldest and earliest cultures on the earth. The Egyptians, like every single culture on earth, learned things from nature. And when they saw the ferocious waves roaring in the sea, they would incorporate it within their pictographic writing system. It may not look like anything significant to your average person, but recent studies have confirmed that it was abbreviated by the Canaanites, and that is where we get our letter M from in the modern English alphabet. It has come down all the way from ancient Egypt. It is probably the most mentioned ancient civilization in the Holy Scriptures, for it was also a place of refuge for many of the biblical patriarchs. Abraham passed through Egypt with his wife Sarah. Joseph was sold as a slave in Egypt but rose to a high position in that land and also married an Egyptian woman and bore her children. Moses carried the children of Israel out of Egypt. Out of all of Solomon's 700 wives and 300 concubines, it is only the Egyptian wife who is singled out and mentioned, as she was a Pharaoh's daughter. Why that is, the narrator has no idea. Solomon also purchased horses from Egypt, for they must have been very strong thoroughbreds. When Jesus was going to be killed as a baby, the angel told Joseph to seek refuge, guess where? In Egypt, in North Africa. So Egypt has played a very, very significant role in history. But there's a very dark side of their history that many are attempting to revive, and they are totally unaware of what they are actually tapping into. In our modern world, many different fields within literature, the arts, and archaeology, with men and women of all different hues, are trying to revive the paganistic practices from ancient Egypt. And the symbol the pharaohs once used, probably as a sign of their authority by the closing of their arms, was first reintroduced in the 20th century by a man named Aleister Crowley. And what Crowley was unable to popularize, the film The Black Panther was able to promote through the arts worldwide. But what is the aim of the Wakanda Forever and the Avatar franchise? They both look strikingly similar in their storylines with underwater scenes. Not much originality there, but they both promote the primitive Afro-Eurasian belief systems of shamanism and voodoo that teaches communication with your dead relatives, ancestor worship, which we shall go into detail later in this study. In the British Museum are copies of a manuscript that teaches people about the afterlife. It is called the Egyptian Book of the Dead, and in the 19th century a school of thought popped up that claimed that Moses just plagiarized the Pentateuch from the Egyptian Book of the Dead. And the narrator will explain where they get their arguments from. The musicians, husband and wife, Jay-Z and Beyoncé, in a music video, Beyoncé is depicted in art as the mother and child. Now, if you go into the British Museum in Europe, they have the mother and child image. In Asia, they have the mother and child image, and in Egypt, in North Africa, you also have the mother and child image. Unfortunately, these images were incorporated into the iconography of the Western churches, and many see Christianity as a scam because of these adopted graven images. Very interesting. Now, if you look at Catholic bishops, they are adorned with a sort of staff or crozier. But if you carefully look through Egyptian art in the British Museum, the pharaohs and the gods like Osiris also had the serpent-hooked croziers. This has made people question how actually authentic is Christianity, not from what is actually in the Bible, but from the pagan practices Christians have stolen. Now, Jesus died on the cross as a complete sacrifice and substitute for fallen man. But the cross is not an emblem to be worn. But today, sadly, Christian ministers and priests wear a cross around their neck. But if you go to the Assyrian section in the British Museum, the Assyrian kings also wore a cross around their necks in homage to their deity, the Sun God. And in the ceremony of the Book of the Dead, the Egyptians had a cross or an ankh, and this can be seen in Egyptian artwork all over the British Museum. And Horem Akhet, who was the son of King Shabaka and the high priest of Amun during the 25th dynasty, this Nubian from the Sudan wears the ankh around his neck. But what is even more interesting is that in the Victoria and Albert Museum in central London in England, there is a Christian cloth dated to the 4th century AD in Egypt, and it has the Egyptian ankh adorned in that Christian Coptic culture. Now, why have the Christians adopted these pagan emblems, and what exactly do they mean? An esoteric writer said that the cross itself is the oldest of phallic emblems. When the zealots of the primitive Christian church sought to Christianize pagandom, the pagan initiates retorted with a powerful effort to paganize Christianity. The Christians failed, but the pagans succeeded. First witness. The most remarkable emblems, independent of the type of deities, were the signs of majesty and dominion, the flail and crook of Osiris. With the Egyptians, the anointing of the king, the sacred tau or sign of life, was presented to him. The early Christians of Egypt adopted it in lieu of the cross, which was afterwards substituted for it. Second witness. So this is one of the arguments that is launched at the church. It is not actually what the Bible teaches, but the pagan customs Christians have adopted and have not let go of. The narrator will just tackle two points to show that this argument is totally ridiculous. When Herodotus was traveling throughout Egypt, he saw something that greatly disturbed him, and this is what he recorded. Certain Egyptians, the Mendicians, will not sacrifice goats, either male or female. In this province in my lifetime, a goat had sexual intercourse with a woman in full view of everybody. A most surprising incident. What is quite sad is that bestiality still exists around the world. The hotspots are in Eurasia. And as you carefully look at these disturbing articles, you can see that man is still nasty. He has not changed one bit. But there are those who insist that Moses' writings are borrowed from the Egyptians. Well, let's see. In Leviticus chapter 20, verses 15 and 16, God said, "And if a man lie with a beast, he shall surely be put to death. And ye shall also slay the beast. And if a woman approach unto any beast and lie down thereto, thou shalt kill the woman and the beast. They shall surely be put to death. Their blood shall be upon them." Yep, Moses was a plagiarist. In Leviticus chapter 18, verses 22 and 23, it reads, "Thou shalt not lie with mankind as with womankind. It is" what? "Abomination. Neither shalt thou lie with any beast to defile thyself therewith. Neither shall any woman stand before a beast to lie down thereto. It is" what? "Confusion." The narrator would like to ask a question. Why does God put the laying down with someone of the same gender and laying down with animals as one and the same thing? Something to think about. The ancient Egyptians took pagan idolatry to a whole new level. Though it is in every culture all over the world, everything that moved in ancient Egypt was either a god or a representative of a deity. Now, if Moses was a plagiarist, according to critics, then he would have adopted this belief system to carry into the Promised Land. But was that the case? The Egyptians, Herodotus says, are religious to excess beyond any other nation in the world, who were the first to assign altars and images and temples to the gods and to carve figures in stone. Not all Egyptians worship the same gods. The only two to be universally worshipped are Isis and Osiris. When the children of Israel left Egypt to go into the Promised Land, God gave to Moses a divine declaration to separate them from the surrounding nations. And on the screen you can clearly see Exodus chapter 20 verses 1 to 6. And highlighted in red, God is very clear, "Thou shalt not make unto thee any graven image." In a book titled Leviathan, written by Thomas Hobbes, an English philosopher and historian, he said that there is no authority neither in the law of Moses nor in the gospel for the religious worship of images or other representations of God which men set up to themselves, or for the worship of the image of any creature in heaven or earth or under the earth. Another relic of Gentilism is the worship of images, neither instituted by Moses in the Old nor by Christ in the New Testament. Before our Savior preached, it was the general religion of the Gentiles to worship for gods those appearances that remain in the brain from the impression of external bodies upon the organ of their senses, which are commonly called ideas, idols, phantasms, conceits, as being representations of those external bodies which cause them and have nothing in them of reality, no more than there is in things that seem to stand before us in a dream. And this is the reason why Saint Paul says, "We know that an idol is nothing." The canonizing of saints is another relic of Gentilism. The carrying about of images in procession is another relic of the religion of the Greeks and Romans, for they also carried their idols from place to place in a kind of chariot. Now, while Protestants are very quick to lambast Catholics for idolatry, they are no different. Who is this an image of? Look very closely. Instantly, you will say that it is Jesus. Why? Because you have been programmed to. But look around museums in Europe and you'll see it is the Greek god Zeus and the Roman god Jupiter, same deities. And they have the same features and the same beard. And the reason Christians can't tell people about idolatry is because what they practice is no different. And who exactly is Zeus? In the British Museum, you can see he manifests himself into an eagle to sexually molest a young boy as a cupbearer. Today, we call it pedophilia. In the same museum is the Egyptian god Amun, who has the head of a goat and the body of a man. And the king from the Sudan, Taharqa in the Bible, is carved within the goat god Amun. This is why the narrator is very skeptical when people keep calling themselves and others the goat. The big city named Meroe, said to be the capital city of the Ethiopians. The inhabitants worship Zeus, Herodotus said. The Egyptians represent Zeus with a ram's head, and Amun is the Egyptian name for Zeus. This is why Christians should stick to the Ten Commandments, so that critics can't say your religion is borrowed from Egypt. The narrator will now tell you what led him to do this study. The Moses plagiarized the Egyptian Book of the Dead argument is one of many schools of higher criticism that the narrator has studied over the years. There are many, many more, and from when the narrator was trained in the Western educational system's way of thinking, when he started his first school till he left university, he has carefully listened to and has logged each one of their arguments. He learned from very early and very quickly from a child that it is a waste of time and pointless going to adults with a deep-rooted and well-conditioned colonial worldview mindset with pressing, thought-provoking questions about the mysteries of life. A church will thoroughly indoctrinate you to be like their community, but will not provide the tools for you when you're being challenged by atheists, agnostics, and militant pan-Africanists outside your church community in the real world. So when the narrator was a teenager, he would study the Bible for himself so that no one could sway his thoughts about God. And he has come to the conclusion that every single argument from the different schools of higher criticism's only aim is to attack creation in the book of Genesis and its divinely inspired author. Let the narrator explain. In the British Museum, there are three tablets from Iraq, which are all different accounts of the flood over thousands of years from southern Babylonia and northern Assyria. And to discredit the Holy Scriptures accounts, they are saying that Moses stole his account from the Babylonians. The men of the Vatican are one of the pioneers in this stupid false accusation to discredit the Holy Scriptures, and it is documented in a book titled A New Song for the Lord by Pope Benedict XVI, where he makes the claim that the pagan creation accounts on which the biblical story is in part based. This accusation was first used in the New York Times in 1914 that said that the Babylonians gave the Bible story to the Jews with the account of the flood and the fall. Very interesting. They are looking to Babylonian sources for the flood story, and one of the new claims is that the Babylonian God, now listen very carefully, not Yahweh, the true God, used fake news to trick Noah into building his ark. Now there is only one way to combat this argument. In a book published in 1849 titled Nineveh and Its Remains, Volume 2, Sir Austin Henry Layard said, "There is not a more attractive subject of investigation, nor one more delusive and uncertain in its result unless carried on with the most rigorous regard to criticism than the origin, derivation, and connection of, guess what? Languages. Etymology, which is the study of the root of words, may now take its place among the sciences, and no science is more important in any investigation connected with the history of the human race." Now, when men and women migrated from Asia Minor and repopulated the earth according to Genesis, the story of the flood was the most memorable account of Earth history because the story was still so fresh in their memory, and it was either preserved in either oral tradition or preserved in stone so that succeeding generations thousands of years later could study the story that has been preserved in every culture on the earth. All of these cultures had a similar way of preserving history. They had handprints in cave art in North America among the natives, among the indigenous of Indonesia in Asia, among the indigenous of France in Europe, and the indigenous handprints in cave art in Shelter Elands Bay in Western Cape in Southern Africa. Now, in the British Museum, the Assyrians of Iraq in Western Asia used cuneiform as their writing system to preserve their history in stone. The men of Crete in Southern Europe, they had a writing system today called Linear A and Linear B, where they preserved their history in stone. And in the culture of the Sudan in Northeast Africa, they had one of the first known alphabets that still has not been fully translated, known as the Meroitic script. The descendants of the Maya in Mesoamerica, today we call Mexico, forefathers had built brilliant architectural monuments with a very solid mathematical genius. But when men attempted to decipher those Mesoamerican glyphs and took note of the oral traditions, they found that the cultures of Mesoamerica had preserved the record of the flood that had wiped out the most of mankind. So Grafton Elliott Smith, the Australian-British anatomist on the left, and Hugh Miller, the self-taught Scottish geologist and writer on the right, as shown in a previous study, Between them both, they discovered that there were hundreds and thousands of flood stories preserved in cultures all over the earth. And why is the Hebrew name Noah and the Chinese name Nuwa and Matsya, an avatar of the Hindu fish god Vishnu, being preserved in different cultures? Why does this fish god save 8 people in a boat? Probably just a coincidence. And why is the Egyptian god seated on the right, whose name is Nu, holding a boat of 8 persons in an Egyptian manuscript on the left? What is the significance of this Egyptian deity called Nu? Some of the sacred boats or arks, Sir John Gardner Wilkinson says, contained the emblems of life and stability, the figure of the divine spirit Neph or Nu. As the spirit of God that moved on the face of the waters, the deity was Neph, Nu or Nam, while he stood in a boat. The Egyptian god Nu was connected to boat and water. Just a coincidence, I suppose. We can look around the world and we can probably guess that though this earth has still a lot of its original beauty still intact, the flood has left its impact. Even at the door showed in a previous study, the home of the biblical patriarch Abraham, which is the city of Ur of the Chaldees, and how Sir Leonard Woolley, the English archaeologist, documented his finds in a book. And there was also a plaque in England, in London, that documents his find in that city in Iraq, in Western Asia. And the British Museum has the largest collection of artifacts from that famous city. And what the narrator is trying to show the viewer is that he's building a case so that people can track the biblical narratives with accuracy, so that you can see that nothing is at all plagiarized. According to Genesis chapter 15 verses 18 to 21, God promises Abraham's descendants that they would inherit the land between Egypt and the river Euphrates, and mentions a number of tribes. The ones highlighted are the Hittites, Amorites, and the Canaanites. Geologists have discovered the location of the Euphrates River, so that is not a problem. We know where that is located geographically. Archaeologists have discovered the Amorites, so they were a tribe, and according to the Louvre Museum in Paris, France, this is what they looked like, descendants of Ham, but with a dark Near Eastern appearance. Though scarce, we have also found what the Canaanites looked like. They were descendants of Ham also, and they also had a Near Eastern look, as well as the Hittites. And it was a land that they occupied that the children of Israel was to inherit. Now here's where linguistics is important, according to Layard. Because as men have been closely studying the dialects in the Bible, they have found something very interesting. They have discovered not only a high volume of Egyptian words in the first 5 books in the Bible, but words that can only be found among remote tribes in Sinai in the Arabian Peninsula. How did these words get into the Bible? A Palestinian Jewish scholar explains to us how. And Abraham Shalom Yehuda said that, with regard to the remaining Genesis stories, the Babylonian myths do not present, as alleged, direct parallels, but merely isolated features and elements from myths of a heterogeneous character, which both in content and conception have very little in common with the Hebrew stories. So these Babylonian tablets that Sir Austin Henry Layard on the right discovered and George Smith on the left deciphered give a totally different account to what is in the Bible. No plagiarism. Argument done. Let's continue. The Genesis stories are dominated by the spirit of the Egyptian language, not the Babylonian. The word Bereshith, which is in the beginning in Genesis chapter 1 and verse 1, with which the creation story begins, is found on close examination to be a close adaptation to the Egyptian expression for earliest time, primeval time. The Akkadian expression Akal Balati, food of life, is quite different from the Hebrew. The Egyptian tree of life corresponds literally with the Hebrew tree of life. Genesis chapter 2 and verse 23, bone of my bones, example, limb of my limbs, has its analogous usage in the Egyptian. In the story of the flood, neither the Akkadian from Mesopotamia is used, nor the Canaanite, but in which long since the Egyptian word box, cough or chest, has been recognized. Case closed. The plenary inspiration of the Holy Scriptures published in 1840 is the book that made this study possible. It was written by a man of French descent who is little known today. His name is Professor François Samuel Robert Louis Gosson, a 19th century Swiss doctor of theology. This man not only traces the origins and root arguments of biblical criticism, also known as higher criticism, but he also humbly but zealously and intelligently dismantles all of their arguments one by one with skill. And within the next 10 minutes or so, everything the narrator comments on can be traced to this very rare out-of-print book, so we can get a clearer background to the modern arguments concerning the Egyptian Book of the Dead. Professor Gosson's ever so eloquently describes this earth's birth at creation, and being versed in the original languages of the East, he shows us that by faith, everything that our naked eye can see, from colors to shapes, was perfectly created by an absolute skillful and intricate detailed designer, who carefully thought things out so that everything in nature harmonizes in sync. When we look at what is left of the animal kingdom, though 99% of the creatures that once inhabited this earth are now extinct, the ones that are left you can see are not only beautiful, but were designed with a distinct purpose and function. And you do wonder in amazement how mortal man believes that they just happened to appear from nowhere, not created. We are all encouraged by God as individuals to study nature, and there was one creature that God singled out that we should learn from, and that is the ant. Not once, but twice in the book of Proverbs, we are told to observe how those community of creatures functions and works together. And guess what? Modern scientists who claim that they do not even acknowledge or recognize that God exists is doing exactly what he has instructed them to do, because they are learning more and more each day from scientific research that in order to organize a society properly, guess who you learn from? The creature, the ant. The Greek word Genesis from the Occident, the West, is a translation of a word from the East, the Orient, the word Bereshit. And the first book in the Holy Scriptures is the oldest and the only document on the earth that gives a detailed account of this earth's origins and who designed it, and the creation of plants with their unique green color that vegetates, grows, and bears seed is absolutely vital to both man and beast. Without plants, the animal kingdom wouldn't last very long, for they are totally dependent on it for both their oxygen and their food. The original diet that God gave to man was a herbivore one. The natural foods from the vegetable kingdom and unbeknownst people, even their different colors, have their own unique and distinct properties about them, which may or not be a shock to many. And when scientists go into the lab to study their different layers within their cells and their unique functions, you'll understand why God gave this to man for his daily consumption. Scientists are confirming that man was originally a herbivore in his diet, and is confirming that early man in Africa, in countries like Mozambique, was eating the herb-bearing seed, and the men in Eurasia titled Neanderthal also had a plant-based diet, though scientists were always adamant that he was a carnivore only. Scientists are also confirming that the colors on each of these foods from the vegetable kingdom has their own distinct antioxidant. And most people have no idea that the leading cause of death from time immemorial to this very day, heart disease and other diseases, can be prevented if man just sticks to his original diet. For 50% of all cancers have been attributed to diet. And though extreme pressure groups like PETA or PETA and the New Age-driven environmental movement have taken the herbivore diet to an extreme, what scientists are continuing to unravel in the lab is only confirming how scientifically accurate the instruction God first gave to man concerning his diet. Man is the center and the completion of creation, where he was created on the sixth day to worship his God, manage the earth, and take care of his fellow man. He comes in all different hues, but all they are just different shades of brown. And we live in a world where people quite strangely think that they are superior if one's skin is lighter or if one's skin is darker. But to continue the cycle of life, God instructed man, that is both male and female, to be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth. But that wasn't the only function for both man and woman to have sex. In a study titled Quantifying the Sexual Afterglow, the Lingering Benefits of Sex and Their Implications for Peer Bonded Relationships, published by the Association for Psychological Science, they analyzed longitudinal studies of newlywed couples, that is, men and women who were recently married, and what did they discover? Results demonstrated that sexual satisfaction remained elevated approximately 48 hours after sex, and spouses experiencing a stronger afterglow reported higher levels of marital satisfaction, both at baseline and over time. We interpret these findings as evidence that sexual afterglow is a proximal cognitive mechanism through which sex promotes peer bonding. So sex was not designed at creation by God to just produce children. It creates bonding between a man and a woman. That is when both parties consent to it. And it helps to reduce tensions so that you can have a healthier home. But as we shall show in a while, this natural biological function that God instituted at creation is under severe attack. Professor Gosson lists a number of the different worldviews that once and still exist throughout Eurasia and throughout the world, and how each one of them offers nothing concerning man's origins and absolutely nothing when it comes to man's eternal future salvation. In the East, the fire-burning religion of Persia, the Zendavesta, or Zoroastrianism, gives no account of man's and earth's origins, and you are left in limbo of how it all started and where you are going. Buddhism gives no account of man's origins. Though it may encourage peaceful living, they believe man can achieve salvation by going into a mystical state of nirvana by emptying their mind. Mani, who founded Manichaeism, also offers nothing but Eastern esotericism, but no explanation for man's origins. The Vedas, or the law of the Hindus, also offers absolutely nothing. And from the East to the West, Greek scholars like Homer in his Iliad and Odyssey, Hesiod, Plato, and Aristotle leave us with only philosophy, but absolutely nothing concerning man's origins and his future destiny, as well as the Apostle Paul's intellectual rivals, Epicurus on the right, who founded the philosophical school of the Epicureans, and Chrysippus on the left, who founded the school or philosophy of the Stoics. Professor Gosson identifies the different players who attempted to undermine the Holy Scriptures and its authenticity. Porphyry, the Syrian Neoplatonist of the 3rd century, and Voltaire, the 18th century French Enlightenment philosopher. But it was an ongoing school of thinking. An Arab by the name of Muhammad, who his followers, the Muslims, call him a prophet, was one of the first to critique the divine authority of the Holy Scriptures. In medieval Europe, Jewish Talmudic scholars began to discredit the divine inspiration of the Holy Scriptures. They included Joseph ben Maimonides, a student of Plato's philosophy. Abraham ben Mir ibn Ezra, and another Jew who revived his works, the Spanish Jewish philosopher Benedict or Baruch Spinoza. The Catholic Encyclopedia Volume 4 lists the Catholic scholars who claimed that Moses did not write the Pentateuch. They are Richard Simon, whose works are on the left, Jean or Jean Astruc in the center, a French professor and Protestant minister who converted to Catholicism, and Alexander Geddes, the 18th century Scottish Roman Catholic theologian. And their ideas of high criticism, titled the Documentary Hypothesis, was to pass over into the Protestant world. That is, men who deny the Bible was divinely inspired, and the narrators will name just a few. Johann Gottfried Eichhorn, the German Protestant theologian who coined the phrase high criticism. Wilhelm de Wet, the German theologian and biblical scholar. William Robertson Smith, the Scottish Orientalist. Edward Roos, the French Protestant theologian. Heinrich Ewald, the German Orientalist and Protestant theologian. Abraham Kuhnen, the Dutch Protestant theologian. And Julius Wellhausen, the German biblical scholar who introduced the Graf-Wellhausen hypothesis, who taught that the Bible cannot be taken literally. All of these men laid the foundation for discrediting the divine authority of the Holy Scriptures that exist today. And the very sign that God gave to man that he will never destroy the world by a global flood again has been hijacked by a community whose aim is to penetrate every sector of society to ridicule what God instituted at creation and to reintroduce a lifestyle of a culture and community within a city of a people that God totally destroyed from the face of the earth. And this undermining of the Holy Scriptures will create doubts about the divine inspiration of the Holy Scriptures, and is ever so cleverly preparing man for the final intense showdown on this earth that will seal everyone's destiny. And with AI and robots taking people's jobs with thousands of layoffs worldwide, machines will replace man as he foolishly attempts to think that he is on the evolutionary journey of becoming a god.
I dreamed of this perfect toy that would protect a kid from ever feeling lonely or sad. This is Megan.
Hi, Megan. I'm Katie. It's nice to meet you, Katie. Do you want to hang out? Okay.
Really, a lot of the idea of eugenics going back to Francis Galton and, you know, Darwinism and all of that, it seems to sort of emanate from there.
Fabian socialists and all of that.
Yes. So in a book in 1957, I believe, called New Bottles for New Wine, something like that, Julian Huxley coins the terms transhumanism and talks about how the new eugenics is going to be merging man with machine.
Genetics, what can it mean? The ability to perfect the physical and mental characteristics of every unborn child.
Of genetic engineering. To choose the genes.
In a sense, society.
Introducing Ectolife, the world's first artificial womb facility, powered entirely by renewable energy. Ectolife allows infertile couple to conceive a baby and become the true biological parents of their own offspring. It's a perfect solution for women who had their uterus surgically removed due to cancer or other complications.
If this becomes a reality, it could mean that same-sex couples could be able to one day have biological children of their own. We could basically just take a blood sample and turn those blood cells first into stem cells and then ultimately into viable human eggs.
At this moment in our civilization, we can create cybernetic individuals who, in just a few short years, will be completely indistinguishable from us. Which leads to an obvious conclusion. We are the gods now.
We are all gods on this planet, every man and every woman. We create life, we can take life, we control what goes into the sea, whether the fish can live or not. We decide if the trees can grow tall. We decide if the children will eat. We are very powerful beings on the planet Earth. And when I said a self-made God, I meant just what I said. Barry White changed his life. So you're right.
Now, black people are ticklish on this because black people think that everything in the Bible is true. I question the intelligence of anyone who thinks everything in the Bible is true or supposed to be true. It's allegory, told, stories told to illustrate a point at a time when there were very few people reading books. And most of what went into the making of the Bible was copied from Egyptian texts. Now, if you want to get so dewy-eyed over the Bible, which is a carbon copy of a carbon copy, why don't you go back and read the original Egyptian text?
The late Pahor Labib, standing on the left, was the director of the Coptic Museum in Cairo, Egypt, and a world leader in Egyptology and Coptology. He is reviewing a number of texts and manuscripts by a group who called themselves the Gnostics, which means self-knowledge, whose gemstones gives you a picture of what this mystic sect believed in. Arising in the apostolic age, their aim was to counteract the spread of the everlasting gospel, and they taught that the early stories in the Bible were just one big allegory, not actual real historical events. The Mosaic account of creation and the fall of man was treated with profane derision by the Gnostics, said Edward Gibbon. Acknowledging that the literal sense is repugnant to every principle of faith as well as reason, they deem themselves secure and vulnerable behind the ample veil of, guess what? Allegory, which they carefully spread over every tender part of the Mosaic dispensation. In a book titled A Book of the Beginnings, Volume 2, the late English poet Gerald Massey said that the original foundational matter of the aptly named Mosaic writings is not and was not historical at all, but entirely mythical. The primordial Exodus, like the Genesis, belongs to the celestial, look at the word, allegory. So he denies they were real stories. In a book titled The Pentateuch and Book of Joshua Critically Examined, the 19th century Anglican bishop John William Collinson repeats that the historical character of the Pentateuch are those which concern the creation, the fall, and the deluge. The first two, this Anglican bishop says, embody some kind of, look at the world, allegorical teaching. In a book titled The Dawn of Conscience, James Henry Breasted, one of the first American Egyptologists, also said, it is now quite evident that the ripe social and moral development of mankind in the Nile Valley, which is 3,000 years older than that of the Hebrews, contributed essentially to the Hebrew literature which we call the Old Testament. Very interesting. Now, Oxford University has produced some fine intellectuals throughout its history and scholars. But even those in religious circles can become so bright, they begin to think that they are more intelligent than God himself and disrespect the Most High by asserting that the holy text is a plagiarized fraud. And the book The History of Ancient Egypt, written by the late George Rawlinson, the Canon of Canterbury, says in Volume 1, it has been said that the 42 laws of the Egyptian religion contained in the 125th chapter of the Egyptian Book of the Dead fall short in nothing of the teachings of Christianity, and conjecture that Moses, in compiling his codes of laws, did but translate into Hebrew the religious precepts which he found in the sacred books of the people among whom he had been brought up. Let's test this argument according to the actual word of God, because the narrator has seen many people leave the church with these unchallenged arguments. One of the modern global trends is to mark up your body with tattoos. It started with rock musicians but exploded under US rappers and Hollywood celebrities. When people begin to stop and question these trends in China, many are requesting that they have their tattoos removed from their body. And all over the world, many are like, why am I putting this foolishness all over my body, looking like some Christmas tree? When they researched some of the oldest tattoos and their origins, they found them on the mummies of ancient Egyptians. Remember, there is nothing new under the sun. But they discovered them all over the world also. Otzi, the Iceman discovered in the Austrian-Italian Alps, dates to around 3350 BC, had tattoos on his body. A Scythian warrior from Eurasia who died about 2400 years ago had tattoos on his body. And the arm of the Lady of Kao in ancient Peru, dated around 1,700 years ago, also has tattoos from the shoulder all the way down to her hand. Now, when God wanted to separate his people to make them distinct and to stand out from the Egyptians and the other surrounding nations, what did he instruct Moses to write? He said in Leviticus chapter 19 and verse 28, "Ye shall not make any cuttings in your flesh for the dead, nor print any marks upon you. Why? I am the Lord." What a plagiarized text. The ancient Egyptians would fall prostrate to a cow and worship it as a god, an animal that was created on the sixth day of creation. Now, Herodotus tells us that bulls are considered the property of the god Epaphus or Apis. Now, when the children of Israel wanted to go back to the pagan religion of Egypt, in a mockery to God, they were dancing completely naked to the Egyptian god, Apis. God found it very degrading that they were worshipping an animal that eats grass. And in Deuteronomy chapter 9 and verse 21, God totally destroyed that man-made idol and ground it to dust, so there was no trace of it. And in Psalms 106, verses 19 and 20, it reads, "They made a calf in Horeb and worshipped the molten or metal image. Thus they changed their glory into the similitude of an ox that eateth grass." Plagiarism. If you were to ever visit the Egyptian Museum in Berlin, Germany, or the Ashmolean Museum in Oxford, England, you would see sculpted images of the 18th dynasty pharaoh, Akhenaten, with him worshipping the blazing sun god that he called Aten. And he got rid of all the other gods in ancient Egypt just to worship the sun god Aten. Now, scholars say Moses borrowed his monotheistic worship and incorporated into the Torah or Pentateuch. But the Babylonians also worshipped the blazing sun in their artwork, and the sun god was called Shamash. Same god, different name. From Asia we go to Europe, where the Romans worshipped the sun god Sol, where we get the word solar system from. But what does God say about sun worship? Because if Moses is a fraud, he would have incorporated in the Holy Scriptures. In 2 Kings chapter 23 and verse 5, the king Josiah removed sun worship when he was reforming Israel back to the true worship of Yahweh. In Ezekiel chapter 8, verses 15 and 16, God said the greatest of all the abominations is when they face the east with their backs toward the temple of the Lord and they worship the sun toward the east. In Job chapter 31, verses 26 to 28, the patriarch also said that the biggest disrespect to God is to honor and worship the sun like the surrounding pagan nations. But men are still saying the stories in the Bible are plagiarized. Oh Lord.
You believe in Jesus? You believe in Prophet?
Well, I definitely don't believe in Jesus.
Okay, that's cool. Do you, why not?
Why not?
I'm just curious.
I think the better question is why. Why would I? Because I'm not 10. Okay? Because, I mean, it's obviously an ancient myth. And, you know, even the Jesus story, his biography, is completely unoriginal. You know, all the gods that came before him had like the same birthday.
And the same story, though, as well.
Same story.
You can always tell when bitter, uncircumcised Gentiles have no clue about true history and embrace inaccurate myths with no documented evidence to verify their claims. If modern-day Christians did not partake in that pagan festival to honor the sun god on December the 25th, critics would have no case against the churches. Now, if you were to ask your average Christian to show them a text in the Bible where Jesus says to keep that day in memory of him, they would not be able to find anything in the Holy Scriptures to support their celebrations. Before we gently dismantle Bill Maher's statement, let us prove some historical facts. The science of archaeology has discovered a ring in the East, and it had inscribed on it a name I believe was written in Latin, and it was a name called Pontius Pilate, and it confirmed that the Bible is not a myth, but historically accurate, according to the Metro newspaper. It was Pilate who ordered Jesus Christ's crucifixion, as documented in RT News. And men, though still arrogant, are seeing the evidence of how historically accurate the Word of God is. This artifact, called the Pilate Stone, has the name Tiberius Caesar and Pontius Pilate engraved on it, and it not only confirms Flavius Josephus' contemporary account of these two historical figures, but it also confirms the biblical account in Luke chapter 3 and verse 1 that mentions both Pontius Pilate and Tiberius Caesar. And you can find busts of Tiberius Caesar in the British Museum in London, England, the Victorian Albert Museum in London, England, and the Louvre Museum in Paris, France, so that when you read the Holy Scriptures, you can have a clear idea of the time period when Jesus Christ was the Messiah in 27 AD, Tiberius' 15th year. Now, the Washington Post says, why is Christmas on December the 25th? It wasn't always. December 25th is not the date mentioned in the Bible as the day of Jesus' birth. The Bible is actually silent on the day or time of year when Mary was said to have given birth to him in Bethlehem. The early Christians, unlike the modern Christians, did not celebrate his birth. First witness. In a book titled Son Law of All Ages by William Tyler Olcott, this American lawyer and amateur astronomer, seated in the center of this photo with a trophy in his hand, when reviewing the origins of Christmas, this is what he said. In our time, a number of Christian religious observances and festivals are of distinct solar origin. Notable among these feast days are Christmas. The Roman winter solstice, says Taylor, as celebrated on December the 25th in connection with the worship of the sun god Mithra, appears to have been instituted in the special form by Aurelian about AD 273, and to this festival, the day owes its opposite name of Birthday of the Unconquered Sun. With full symbolic appropriateness, though not with historical justification, the day was adopted in the Western Church, where it appears to have been generally introduced when by the 4th century. And once in time it passed to the Eastern Church as the solemn anniversary of the birth of Christ, Christmas Day. As a matter of history, no valid or even consistent early Christian vouches for it. Second witness. It is very ridiculous to compare Jesus with anybody. Which God said, I am coming back again, gave a detailed account on the economic, spiritual, and environmental condition of this earth just prior to his second coming, and said, I am going to rebuild this earth anew from scratch. Where at this time, you can go directly to the Father through Him, who are both one, without the intermediary of no earthly priest, where it does not cost a thing. We shall cite a few more examples and challenge arguments that have gone untouched for years. The late Cheikh Anta Diop was a Senegalese historian, anthropologist, physicist, and politician who was the director of the radiocarbon laboratory at the University of Dakar in Senegal. He wrote a book titled The African Origin of Civilization, and he also made the plagiarized claim. Circumcision is of Egyptian and Ethiopian origin. We can understand why the Semites practiced circumcision despite the fact that their traditions present no valid justification for it. The weakness of the arguments in Genesis is typical. God asks Abraham and later Moses to be circumcised as a sign of a covenant with him, without explaining how circumcision, considered from the standpoint of Jewish tradition, can lead to the notion of alliance. This is all the move curious because Abraham was allegedly circumcised at the age of 90. In Egypt, he had married a Negro woman, Hagar, mother of Ishmael, the biblical ancestor of the second Semite branch, the Arabs. Ishmael is said to be the historical ancestor of Muhammad. Moses to wed a Midianite, and it was in connection with his marriage that the Eternal asked him to be circumcised. What should be noted in these legendary tales is the idea that circumcision was introduced among the Semites only as a result of a contact with the black world, which confirms the testimony of Herodotus. Now, this image from an Egyptian tomb dated to the 6th dynasty around 2345 BC may be one of the oldest images in the world of circumcision, which Herodotus did say was practiced in Africa. The 18th century abolitionist Olaudah Equiano said circumcision was practiced among his people, the Igbo of Nigeria in West Africa. And Philip Caramon, the Jesuit priest in his studies on Ethiopia, said it was also practiced in East Africa, which were initiation of young teen males into adolescenthood. But besides the continent of Europe, circumcision was practiced all over the world, not just in Africa, and recent studies has confirmed this. In a study titled Neonatal and Child Male Circumcision, a global review, we get a much more wider documented account of the practice of circumcision. And it says that male circumcision, which is practiced for social, cultural, and medical reasons, is one of the oldest and most common surgical procedures performed globally. Circumcision has been widely practiced for non-religious reasons for many centuries in West Africa and in parts of Central East and Southern Africa, as well as among Aboriginal Australians and the Aztecs and Mayas in the Americas, in the Philippines and Eastern Indonesia, and on various Pacific islands, including Fiji and the Polynesian Islands. More recently, circumcision has become common in other settings, including the USA and the Republic of Korea. But when you open up the Holy Scriptures, you are introduced to a completely different type of circumcision that is totally separate to the rest of the world. In Genesis chapter 17 and verse 12, Leviticus chapter 12 and verse 3, and Luke chapter 1 and verse 59. It is very specific and clear that circumcision is to start when a child is only 8 days old. Now, why is that and what is the significance? When a baby is born, in its first week, something very interesting happens in those early developments that takes place on the 8th day. In Nigeria, in the Department of Medical Laboratory Science, River State University, a number of scholars published a study titled Hematological Basis of 8-Day Male Child Circumcision in the Holy Bible, and it documented that The vitamin K and thrombosin, which is a blood clotter, are the highest in a baby on his eighth day of life. The vitamins belong to the K group are involved in the carboxylation of glutamate residues in proteins to form gamma carboxglutamate residues, GLA residues typically located within GLA domains. These GLA residues, which are usually involved in calcium binding, are essential for the function of most, if not all, known GLA proteins. Conclusively, it is of medical importance that male circumcision be carried out on the eighth day after birth, since the level of vitamin K is highest on this day, and vitamin K plays a vital role in regulation and control of the important clotting factors in the coagulation pathway that helps in stopping bleeding. So the circumcision that God instituted on the eighth day is completely different to the one that existed in the continent of Africa and throughout the other nations all over the world.
Have you ever been told you're different, odd, or simply don't belong? In a world full of normies, do you feel like an outcast? Me too. But I'm pleased to tell you there's a very special place for people like us. Nevermore Academy.
Nevermore was founded over 200 years ago to educate outcasts.
Students from all walks of life.
And death. Visit www.nevermoreacademy.com to apply today. We simply can't wait to make your acquaintance.
The occult and its ever so clever call back to nature worship is spreading rapidly among this young generation, and looks very, very attractive because it is cleverly packaged as empowering women. As many men have sadly abused their roles as leaders and protectors of women, women are being marketed to and initiated into the ancient black arts. And it does not matter if they are of European descent, Asian descent, or of African descent. If you were to go back in time, its rebirth started in the 19th century in Victorian Britain with famous women from left to right like Madame Helena Petrovna Blavatsky, Annie Besant, and Alice Anne Bailey. And it is presented to modern women as feminism, where they are told that they must embrace their inner hag or witch, where they can become a goddess like the pagan ones of Egypt, like Isis or Ma'at. But its most successful recruiting drive is the internet, especially in social media. Whereas women who are searching for an identity browse online, they will be hooked into this modernist empowerment drive, where studies are showing that TikTok has now become the home of modern witchcraft, which is being called Witch Talk, and their videos have billions of views. So as more and more women get hooked, it will start opening the door into deeper and darker arts that will come off as harmful fun when they start playing around with the forces of nature. But the narrator is convicted that it is going to open up a door into people's bodies being taken hold of by unclean spirits. And this digital metaverse world is leading people to the worship of the dragon and going back to the pagan religion of Egypt. Herodotus tells us that the Egyptians were also the first to assign each day to a particular deity and have made more use of omens and prognostics than any other nation with the use of the art of, look at the word highlighted in green, divination. Now, when the children of Israel left the land of Egypt to go into the land of Canaan, God gave Moses a clear divine instruction to separate the children of Israel from the surrounding nations. And in Deuteronomy chapter 18, verses 9, 10, and 11, God said that when thou art come into the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee. Thou shalt not learn to do after the what? Abominations of those nations. And what are these abominations that God lists? Thou shalt not be found among you anyone that maketh his son or his daughter to pass through the fire, or that useth divination like the Egyptians, or an observer of times, or an enchanter, or a witch, or a charmer, or a consulter with familiar spirits, or a wizard, or a, look at the word highlighted in white, necromancer. That is someone who attempts to contact the dead. And we shall continue the rest of this study on that topic. The narrator was filming a kind of New Age parade or celebration on Tottenham Court Road in central London in England. It was a kind of return to Britain's pre-Christian pagan roots, and one man kind of stood out to the narrator. He held a banner of a raven in his hand, his body was painted all in black, and he had horns on his head, and he stuck out his big old tongue to the narrator. Which god did this man represent? Who was black and had horns on his head? It was a man by the name of Nimrod, the first ruler and king in Genesis chapter 10. And thousands of years later, people are still worshipping a black man to this very day. But why are people turning back to the oldest pagan religions? There are a number of reasons why. In London's Financial Times, an article titled Witch Talk, How the Occult Became Big Online, gives us one of the reasons, and a portion of it said that turbulent times often produce spiritual movements, says Sarah Harvey, a research associate in King's College London's Department of Theology and Religious Studies. The golden age of spiritualism was between the First and Second World Wars, she says. There is a deep spiritual vacuum in the hearts of men, and they want it to be filled. And sadly, the churches that are meant to provide answers and is meant to be the light of the world, to comfort people and be a safe place, are ignoring the dire needs of the wider society that they live in. And people can see right through their fraudulent behavior. And if the world is saying, well, we can't really define what a woman is according to Cambridge Dictionary, and if the church is also saying there is no official definition of a woman, people are going to look outside of the church for answers. So among Eurasians, they are going back to the religions of nature. And while all these modern movements look different on the surface, when you take away the layers, they are all the same. The Moscow Times says Siberia is celebrating its ancient culture of shamanism. Al Jazeera also says that one of the world's oldest spiritual belief systems is getting a revival in Siberia, and The Guardian documents that it is also having a revival in Mongolia in Asia. But it is spreading throughout Europe also. In the UK, shamanism is also seeing a revival, and people from all different walks of life are turning to shamanism. How fast is it actually spreading and growing in the UK? The London Guardian, when documenting the rise of different trends, said that shamanism is expanding faster than any religion, with the number of people saying they practice it rising from 650 in 2011 to 8,000 in 2021 in England and Wales. That is a huge leap in 10 years. But what exactly is shamanism? The Guardian says it is people who claim that they are contacting the dead, ancestor worship. This woman said in The Guardian, "My ancestors are circled around my space." The shaman gives thanks to the nature spirits, the animals, the trees, and my spirit guides, both known and unknown. This was once a known global belief system, and all the world at one time practiced this pagan idea, where they served the creature more than the creator. Now, in a book titled The Secret Teachings of All Ages by Manly Palmer Hall, it documents that the civilizations of Greece, Rome, Egypt, China, and India believed implicitly in satyrs, spirits, and goblins. These, and highlighted in green, nature spirits were held in the highest esteem and propitiatory offerings were made to them. Now, when the narrator tells people that all roads will eventually lead to Rome, he knows exactly where it is leading to, a system which is the habitation of devils and the hold of every foul bird and unclean spirit. This system is not only endorsing all these pagan religions, but eventually it will lead out, for in an online debate on a show called Grapevine concerning African spirituality, where some were zealously and boldly defending the kingdom of God with no apologies, something very rare among modern Christians in the West, one admitted that her African religion was just like, identical, or the same as Catholicism.
Mm-hmm. Which is weird because when you think of Catholicism, right, you're drinking the blood, right? Mm-hmm. But it's because it's wine. We're like, oh, yeah, it's fine. We know it's sweet wine. But it's the same thing. Blood cleanses you. You have to kill some things to cleanse yourself. Mm-hmm. You're putting dirt on your face, right? When you're during Lenten season, you're burning papers, you're doing all of that. You have to rub yourself in dirt to get some things. You're praying to idols in a way too. So it's the same thing.
Though the narrator was born in the UK, his parents are from the Caribbean in the British West Indies. And when you are raised in a Caribbean home with oral tradition, you hear about the Jambi and the Lejables and the West African beliefs of the Adapi and the Abaku, beliefs that are all connected with the dead. Many within the black community are returning to these belief systems with this very strange idea that it will connect them with their African roots. But they have little idea that ancestor worship can be found in every culture all over the world. And the voodoo or hoodoo that men are returning back to is nothing more than nature worship.
That's all it is.
Yes.
Voodoo and all that, it's you connecting with nature and the spirit realm. Mm-hmm. That's all, because it's all the same.
Right.
What do you think is misunderstood about voodoo?
Le voodoo est universel. Ce n'est pas les noirs seulement qui sont les enfants du voodoo. Partout dans le monde entier, il y a le voodoo. Une fois que l'air se manifeste dans n'importe quelle religion, dans quelque région, donc il y a le voodoo là. Le voodoo est basé sur les quatre éléments de la nature. Il y a l'air, l'eau, le feu et la terre.
This supreme chief of voodoo in Benin in West Africa confirmed that voodoo is not a black African belief system only, but it is connected to the four elements. Now, there was a film that came out called Avatar: The Last Airbender, promoting Eastern philosophy to the public. And the main hero, the young boy, was to control the what? The four elements, the same thing as voodoo, just with a different name.
It's the duty of the Avatar to restore balance to the world. You must master the four elements and confront the Fire Lord.
Now, if you look at the film The Hobbit, one of the main characters, I think it is Gandalf, is dressed in his large wizard hat as his authority. Now, if you look at the singer called Maxi Priest with DJ Cassidy, he also looks like he has a similar hat with some New Age pendant around his neck. The New Age is all leading to the same goal. This photo is of a witch. She is a white woman with tattoos, a skull head around her neck, decorated with animal bones and bird feathers in her head. Now, when you look at these black women who practice voodoo or hoodoo, they also have tattoos, rings in their noses, and skull heads. Guess what? It is all the same thing. And what is really frightening is that the narrator knows of many scenarios where people of black African descent are practicing Obia on their own church brethren. I repeat, people are practicing Obia on their own church brethren. The New York Times published an article in 1972 detailing exactly what Obia is, and it documented that when Africans were shipped to the New World, they were forced to relinquish language, culture, and religion. They were stripped of everything about them. Now, black magic they managed to cling to, perhaps because represented revenge and hate for them. Obia, or necromancy, that is contacting the dead, is throughout the Caribbean islands brought over centuries ago by African slaves. Animal entrails may be a part of the Obia bag. Now, if you go into the British Museum, the ancient Romans used animal entrails in their occult practices. And in the Babylonian section, the men of Mesopotamia in the Middle East also practice it, which the prophet Ezekiel was an eyewitness to and recorded their occultism in that prophetic book. Now, the narrator would like to make a brief disclaimer. White Europeans were not spreading the everlasting gospel to black slaves during slavery. They were using their bodies to build up the Western world's financial capital. So this is why the slaves held on to their beliefs, because this was all that they knew. The New York Times continues. Obia has no creed or organized service of worship. In the language of the Ashanti, Obefo meant wizard, and Obi in East African meant sorcery or fetishism. Look at the words highlighted in green. The etymology has been traced to ancient Egyptian mythology, in which Ob meant serpent. So Obia is serpent worship. And Moses warned the Israelites not to recognize the Ob, translated in the Bible as divinatory or sorcerer. First witness. In a book titled Osiris, the Egyptian Religion of Resurrection, E. A. Wallace Budge elaborates and says, and this is quite lengthy, many African funerals and the funerals of the ancient Egyptians is too close and too widespread to be the result of accident. The indigenous Egyptians, being Africans, bury their dead like Africans. As early as 3500 BC, the Egyptians believed that gods became incarnate in man. Now, if we examine the religions of modern African peoples, we find that the beliefs underlying them are almost identical. A very large number of tribes in Africa believe firmly in the existence of a host of evil spirits, which they generally identify with the souls of the dead. The views of modern African peoples about spirits and their world throw much light upon the denizens of the Egyptian Tuat mentioned in the Egyptian Book of the Dead. Colonel Ellis says there is more fetishism among the Negroes of the West Indies who have been Christianized for more than half a century than amongst those of West Africa. For side by side with the new religion have lingered the old superstitions, whose true import has become forgotten or corrupted. Hence the belief in Obia, still prevalent in the West Indies, which formerly was a belief in indwelling spirits which inhabited certain objects, the same as shamanism, just a different name, has now become a reverence or worship paid to tangible and inanimate objects, which of themselves are believed to possess the power to injure. According to Major A. G. Leonard, fetishism and idolatry are the two chief branches of the main channel of ancestral worship, which forms the foundation of naturism. The spirit or deity symbolized in any object, be it tree, stone, animal, etc., is in every case the personification of the ancestor. The essence of true Negro religion is ancestor worship. So is Eurasian shamanism. a belief in the ghosts of the departed. Now, if we compare the worship or reverence paid by the Egyptians to the spirits of certain trees, shamanism, or to the spirit of the Nile, or to the spirit of the gods, with the worship of the spirits of like character by modern African peoples, we find its theory and practice to be identical. The Egyptians worshipped their ancestors whose spirits they located in statues and figures, and nature spirits that Manly P. Hall said was in all pagan nations of all kind. The Egyptians regarded certain kind of snakes with reverence. The serpent was either a power for good or the incarnation of diabolical cunning and wickedness. Similar views are held concerning the serpent by modern African peoples. The Egyptian Book of the Dead mentions the serpent Amenhemhet. This is a mummy that is dated to the 18th dynasty in 1400 BC. It is of a Nubian of the Sudan whose name is Merherpi. Now, in his coffin was found a copy of the Egyptian Book of the Dead, one of the most intact one ever recovered. And on the top right, you can see the serpents. There are men in Benin in West Africa who have temples where the python is engraved on the doors. And many blacks are running back to this pagan religion with the idea that it is connecting them or reconnecting them to their ancestors. But guess what? The Yazidis in Iraq do the exact same thing, where they also have temples dedicated to the serpent. And you realize all the pagan religions are exactly the same. And if you go to the British Museum, the Yazidis religion can be traced to their ancestors in ancient Babylon, modern-day Iraq. So voodoo is a global universal religion of nature serpent worship. Shamanism under a different name, and we shall show that all of these belief systems are going to lead you to the belief in the immortality of the soul.
I believe the dead haunt us because we love them too little.
What is this?
Blood, symbols, rituals.
Oh, my lord.
Man will do most anything to cheat death.
Need you to decipher this.
Rumor has it there are instructions for immortality.
It's gonna be me.
It's happened already?
What did you say?
Our ancestors had a mystical connection with red pandas.
Are you kidding me?
This little quirk runs in our family.
Any strong emotion,
yes,
will release the panda.
I'm Darby Harper. Just watch me. Are you sitting down for this? I see dead people. I help them pass on to the next realm.
It is irrefutable. Our consciousness continues beyond our physical bodies. My life beyond study is strictly a volunteer program.
So why can some people see ghosts?
The strong connection between Rio and his father brought them together, and the rest as well. History in the making.
는 2017년 4월 28일 오늘 예정대로 무사히 사망하셨습니다.
다시 환생할 수 있는 망자에게는 이승에 보고 싶은 사람에게 딱
오하는 짓이야!
그곳에서는 타인의 믿음을 저버렸던 망자들을
어려움에 처한 이들을 그리 돕고 싶었느냐?
돈 때문이었습니다.
Money? 너 뭐라 그랬니?
down!
This is a Christian house. We left all those beliefs with our elders. Do you understand?
I call upon the Orishas of the land of the ancestors. Show the people that I is not me. I is we. And we is power.
You are my beloved. I am Oshun. I will uphold you in your courage to carry life forward.
I am Yamoja, the water. When the burden is too great, you rest in my arms.
I am Aye, the earth beneath you. You bleed upon me, and I bleed upon you.
All over this planet, no matter what geographical location you would enter into, whether you are of Afro-Eurasian descent, nearly all peoples believed in the exact same thing concerning life after death. And this may or may not shock you. Sir James George Frazer was a Scottish-born British anthropologist, folklorist, and classical scholar. He published a three-volume set book between 1913 and 1924, titled The Belief in Immortality and the Worship of the Dead, that covered the beliefs of the Aborigines of Australia and the inhabitants of the Torres Strait Islands, New Guinea and Melanesia. And though it is layered with a deeply racial colonial bias, it showed that they all believed in the immortality of the soul. In North America, in both the pre- and post-European colonial invasion, the Native American tribes that were scattered all over, not all of them, but most of them, believed in the immortality of the soul. Freemasonry of the Ancient Egyptians was a book written by the late Canadian-born esoteric historian Manly Palmer Hall, and he documented and wrote that Plato journeyed to Egypt, where from Pausanias we also gather that it was the Egyptians that Plato learned the mystery of, guess what, the immortality of the human soul. Plato, the Greek philosopher from the classical period's worldview, was shaped by the ancient Egyptians. And Herodotus tells us from his studies that the Egyptians were also the first people to put forward the doctrine of the, guess what, immortality of the soul. But there are more. In a book titled Babylonian Life and History, E. A. Wallace Budge documents also that among the Babylonians, the belief in, guess what, the immortality of the soul was, guess what, fundamental. If you ever come to Walmore Station in the UK, a 20-minute or half an hour walk, you'll arrive at a beach and there is a small monument dedicated to a man who landed there who was expanding his Roman Empire. And when Julius Caesar was closely observing the beliefs and practices of the inhabitants of the British Isles, he documented it in a book titled Caesar's Gaelic Wars. And these are his own words. The Gaelic tribes as a whole are slaves of superstition. This is how he described the people of Britain. The Druids are a priestly caste. The Druidical doctrine is commonly supposed to have reached Gaul from its original home in Britain. Their central dogma is, guess what, the immortality and transmigration of the soul, a doctrine which they regard as the finest incentive to courage since it inspires contempt for death. So we have gone around the world and we have seen that they all believed the exact same thing. But where did that doctrine of the immortality of the soul actually come from? Well, we have to go back in time to the earliest known documented episode in human history. where a very beautiful animal was used as a medium to create a revolution to counteract God's divine authority. For every belief has its roots. In the Holy Scriptures in Romans chapter 5 and verse 12, we are told that all men in this life will experience death at some stage because of the free will decision and disobedience of one man's choice. But what did he do? In Genesis chapter 2, verses 16 and 17, God gave man a choice of free will and introduced to man something that we still find very hard to digest: death. But the godfather of higher criticism made man doubt God's authority in Genesis chapter 3 and verse 4, and introduced to mankind the foundation of the teachings of the immortality of the soul, which is the root of reincarnation and ancestor worship, that teaches, well, you're not really dead, you're just going through some cycle. Now, if the Bible is meant to be a plagiarized copy from the Egyptians, then it should teach the exact same thing. Well, let us see. On this road in central London, a man was compiling a huge volume set for the public to have at their disposal. And in a set of books titled The History of the Decline and Fall of the Roman Empire, the 18th century Oxford-educated English historian Edward Gibbon said that the doctrine of the immortality of the soul is omitted or not mentioned in the law of Moses. But we can't just have one witness, we need two or three. Golders Green Crematorium Cemetery in Barnet in northwest London has the urn or ashes of an Austrian psychologist by the name of Sigmund Freud. This man spent his last days in this house in Hampstead in northwest London. And this Austrian fled here to escape death from another Austrian, Adolf Hitler. Now, Freud wrote a book titled Moses and Monotheism. And though it was an attack on the authority of the Bible and Moses, the narrator still found a nugget of truth in that volume. And Freud said that the early Jewish religion had entirely relinquished, guess what? Immortality. The possibility of an existence after death was never mentioned in any place. Well, that's one argument settled. But what did the Egyptians actually believe happened to you at the point of death concerning the immortality of the soul? We shall quote one of the best authorities in that era of study from the manuscripts in the British Museum. In a book titled The Egyptian Book of the Dead that details their beliefs of the afterlife, the late E. Wallace Budge said, "In the papyrus of Ani, the deceased is represented as having come to a place remote and far away. The deceased is changed into Horus, the son of Osiris and Isis. In addition to the natural and spiritual bodies, man also had an abstract individuality and personality endowed with all his characteristics. This was the Ka. To that part of man which beyond all doubt was believed to enjoy an eternal existence in heaven in a state of glory, the Egyptians gave the name Ba. When the Osiris of man entered into heaven as a living soul, he is regarded as one of those who have entered the eye of Horus." In the British Museum, you can see artifacts in the Egyptian section of what the Egyptians called the Ba. The Ba had the head of a human, it could be male or female, and the body of a bird. And the Egyptians believed that this was your immortal soul that entered into heaven at death. This was the foundation of their belief in the immortality of the soul. These two upstretched arms was called the Ka, that they believed was your abstract individuality and personality. But what you may find shocking is that most Christians in the world teach not what the Bible says, but the doctrine of the immortality of the soul, and even non-Christians.
Honestly, first purgatory, now hell, what's next? Heaven.
I woke up that morning with more heart to give you as I bleed through the speakers, feel my presence. To my brother, to my kids, I'm in heaven. To my mother, to my sis, I'm in heaven. To my father, to my wife, I am serious, this is heaven. To my friends, make sure you count them blessings. To my fans, make sure you make them investments. And to the killer that spared at my demise, I forgive you, just know your soul's in question.
The Apostle Paul says to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. And so one of the things that Bible-believing Christians believe about the intermediate state, meaning what happens between the very moment that you die and then what happens between that time and the final resurrection, the coming of Christ, the setting up of the eternal kingdom. What's so important for believers to understand now is that we go immediately to the presence of Christ. And that's important for assurance of salvation. And it's important for comfort in the wake of the death of a loved one.
Well, sooner or later, if you're a Christian, you're going to enter the afterlife. And if you put your faith in Christ, you're going to go to heaven. What a great hope that is. The Bible says to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. You'll close your eyes on earth and you'll open them in heaven. So we have basic two modes of transportation to get us to the afterlife if we're a believer. It's either going to be death or the rapture.
Historically, classical Christian theology speaks of what we call the status intermedius, or the intermediate state. And that has to do with where we go immediately upon death, as distinguished from our state after the final resurrection. That is to say, as the New Testament would indicate, Paul says to depart is better than to stay. It was more needful to stay here for us, but to depart and be with Christ was far better. And he certainly indicates that as soon as we die, our souls go immediately into the presence of God and into the presence of Christ. But in that particular intermediate state, we're disembodied souls. And we won't have our glorified bodies until after the coming of Christ and the great resurrection, where our souls will then, at that point, be reunited with our bodies. So first, souls, continued consciousness of our personal existence. The instant we die, we go into heaven in our soul state, and then we await the final consummation of the resurrection of our bodies.
Now, we respect these three individuals' positions, but we have to correct it in love through the Holy Scriptures. During the reign of the English Tudor monarch, King Henry VIII, a very intense ideological war was taking place between two men. In Chelsea in South London is a monument of Sir Thomas More, the Lord Chancellor and the Speaker of the House of Commons, who was teaching the Catholic doctrine of the immortality of the soul, which was inherited from the Egyptian Book of the Dead. And in London's Embankment Gardens was the Oxford-educated scholar and Bible translator William Tyndale, who taught the apostolic teaching of the early church, which is the first resurrection. Tyndale said to More, "And ye, in putting them in heaven, hell, and purgatory, as the Egyptian Book of the Dead teaches, destroy the arguments with Christ and Paul prove the resurrection. If the souls be in heaven, in as great glory as the angels, after your doctrine from the Egyptian Book of the Dead, Tyndale is asking every person, Christian or non-believer, a very personal question. Show me what cause is the point of the first resurrection if you are already in heaven, like the ancient Egyptians believed." The early church that started in Jerusalem in the Orient, in the East, in Asia, taught the teaching of the resurrection. But one man changed the game forever, and he still impacts a large portion, or the majority, of what is left of Christendom. His name was Emperor Constantine, and most of the paganism you see in the churches are due to his compromises. But before his socializing of Christianity, in a book titled The Approaching End of the Age, the Irish-born evangelist Dr. Henry Grattan Guinness said, "The passage of scripture which more fully than any other dwells on the subject of the resurrection, the subject which has illumined the darkness of death to successive generations of Christians, is the 15th chapter of the first epistle to the Corinthians." The early church, with one consent, placed the millennium after the advent or the second coming of Christ. All the primitive expositors and teachers were premillennialists, which means that at the second coming of Christ, the saints will reign with him for 1,000 years in heaven. All the early fathers up to the time of Constantine, including Justin Martyr, Irenaeus, Tertullian, Hippolytus, Victorinus, Methodius, Lactantius, held that the first resurrection of Revelation chapter 20 was a literal resurrection. The resurrection of the dead will take place in two stages, with 1,000 years between. There will be two resurrections, first of the just and secondly of the unjust. From Dean Alford's commentary on the New Testament, we extract in conclusion the following testimony of the doctrine of two distinct resurrections of the dead. Those who lived next to the apostles and the whole church for 300 years, just before Constantine, understood them in the plain literal sense, and it is a strange sight in these days to see expositors, that is, men who outwardly claim their belief in the authority of the Bible, who are among the first in reverence of antiquity, which is the original teachings, blatantly or complacently casting aside the most cogent instance of consensus which primitive antiquity presents. So there is a clear distinction between the teachings of the Egyptian Book of the Dead and what Moses was divinely inspired to write by God in the first five books in the Old Testament, and also the teachings in the New Testament. The Holy Scriptures in both the Old and New Testament teaches in Job chapter 4 and verse 17 and Romans chapter 6 and verse 12 that man is nothing more than a mortal being. A mortal, according to the Reader's Digest Great Encyclopedic Dictionary, volume 2, says, "To be mortal is subject to or causing death." So 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verse 26 says that death will be destroyed at the end of time. No immortality before then. 1 Corinthians chapter 15 verses 17 and 18 calls death asleep. So when you die, it looks like you're sleeping. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15 verses 12 and 35, many questioned the first resurrection, for they couldn't explain how it could work, because it did not sound normal to them. But in 1 Corinthians chapter 15 verses 51, 52, 53 and 54, this is the only document on the face of the earth that clearly teaches that immortality can only take place at the second coming of Christ, at the first resurrection. So we can clearly see from the plain text of the Holy Scriptures that the Bible is not a plagiarized text from the Egyptian Book of the Dead.
Well, did Moses borrow from the Egyptian Book of the Dead? I think not. I just want to say thank you for all those who have supported Even at the Doors for these 10 years. And if you want to continue supporting it, you can go to www.evenatthedoors.uk
www.evenatthedoors.uk. And as I encourage at all times, please research everything you have seen in this study. Thank you for the support.